Hello there. Welcome back to another draft video here on Channel Fireball. Marshall from Limited Resources, and we're jumping into, what is this? Theros Beyond Death. Guess I just take Shatter of the Sky here. I've found that Shatter of the Sky is not optimally positioned in the format. The prevalence of escape cards, plus the fact that you can chip your opponent a card here, can be off-putting, but it's still the most powerful card in that pack by a lot and worth a pick here. Interesting. So we've got Terranika, a Crowan veteran. Somebody took an uncommon from this pack. There's also Nyx Herald and Illyrios. I really like Nyx Herald. I like Illyrios, but I really like Nyx Herald. But yeah, I mean, we got a sweet rare pass to us, and we'll just take it. We'll just roll with it here. Here I'm going to take Daybreak Chimera. There is a Mystic Repeal, which is a card that I like quite a bit. This is one that pumps up the guy. It's fine. But I mean, I kind of like where this is going. We're all white. We can figure out where we want to go from there a little bit later. Lagunaban Storytellers, fine. 3-4 for 4. It gets an enchantment back, but it's on top of your library, so it's not card advantage. But you do gain some life, and sometimes it's worth it. So I'll just take it here. And we'll kind of figure out what our other color is going to be when we get to that point. But, you know, of course, one of the most powerful things you can do in a booster draft is to be heavily in one color in the first pack, assuming that the cards are flowing in that way, and then leaving yourself the opportunity to move into any color, any secondary color in the second pack. Of course, if you end up in a equal split of, let's say, white and black cards coming out of the first pack, and you're pretty dedicated to both colors, and you open up a blue bomb, it puts you in a really compromising position. Are you going to ditch a full half of your deck to try to make it work, or are you going to go in a different direction? And so those are kind of the questions that you face when you're equally distributed on colors, but when you're not, you don't have to make that decision. You can just be like, sweet, I'll just take it. Here, I could take Captivating Unicorn. Indomitable Will's decent. I like Mogus's Favor quite a bit. Omen of the Sun's playable, but not great. Tempted to take the Unicorn, but generally speaking, five drops aren't really a priority. And we've already got the Daybreak Chimera, which is going to be a four or five drop for us. Let's take Indomitable Will here, a cheaper card. Transcendent Envoy, Pious Wayfarer. Now, there is an Ichthyomorphosis, which is a card I like quite a bit. There's also a Final Flare, which is a card I like a little bit. Thirst for Meaning I like, too. So we've got some options. If there was a big incentive to stay mono-white, we could take Envoy or Pious Wayfarer, but there really isn't that big of an incentive, so I'm just going to take Ichthyomorphosis here as kind of the in-between. Interesting. So no amazing cards. I'm just actually going to take the Temple. If we end up blue-white, the Temple, you know, overperforms. Soul Guide Lantern for the board. Underworld Rage Hound is probably the best card here, or I could take Traveler's Amulet. I'll just do that. And it looks like red is vaguely open. I'll take this Captivating Unicorn. Elite Instructor will be my pick here. Rumbling Sentry I don't think is playable, and the Instructor is, not that it's great, but it's okay. So if we end up in blue, we'll probably end up with this in our deck. And if we don't, that's the kind of card I can just jump over here, no problem, and not really worry about it. Same thing with Ichthyomorphosis. It's a much better card than Elite Instructor, but yeah, it's not one of the best cards in the set or a reason to be in blue, so we can... Again, if we open up, like, let's say we open up some sweet black rare or something like that, we could just take it. Okay, I'll take the Flicker of Fate. And white did seem pretty open. You know, not absurd or anything, but we got past a white rare and then got a decent white common after that, so it's okay. You know, this thing came back a little late, not that it's super desirable. Flicker of Fate can do some things in the format. So, yeah. I think we actually did manage to solidify ourselves into one color. But without really getting anything game-breakingly amazing. You know, we didn't pick up any dreadful apathies or ways to search them up or anything like that, for example. Sure. There's that unicorn that I almost took. I don't think the second one's good. And then there's Pious Wayfarer, so we got all this stuff back anyway. So let's look at our curve, and let's really hope we open up something awesome here to take advantage of our openness. These are all kind of the whatevers, and then we've got this core of white cards and something sweet. Ooh, we got an Ephemia. That is a very good card. Is there anything good in our colors? Phalanx Tactics is okay. Yeah, no, I think I'm going to take Ephemia the Cacophony here. This card is better than our blue cards by a lot. Let's just see how this looks. There's also a world where we splash, you know, that's not unheard of. But Ephemia's been a very strong card. A must kill most scenarios. Good value. All right. Kanoros is next. Sweet. So it looks like our patience paid off. We picked up two black cards in our first two picks, both rare, both very strong. And they go into our deck pretty nicely too. So that's great. What do we got? Agonizing Remorse. I like that card quite a bit. Enemy of Enlightenment, I still haven't really got a good feel for how great it is at the point that I'm drafting this, which is probably draft number like 8 or something like that. Karametra's Blessing I like quite a bit. And Sentinel's Eye has overperformed. But yeah, I like Agonizing Remorse quite a bit. So I'm going to take it here. Here I could take Leona to the Lost Pride. I actually really like the Birth of Miletus. I know it's not great, but I like what it does. I'm just going to take one here. All right, there's the bingo. Dreadful Apathy. Unfortunately, it did come in the same pack with the Heliod's Pilgrim, and we kind of want both, but one is slightly more important than the other. So we'll take the Dreadful Apathy, and maybe we'll wheel the Pilgrim if nobody else, you know, has a good target or whatever. They may just pass it. Although that said, what pick was that? That was pick 5 or 6, so yeah, maybe we won't have enough cards left to even consider wheeling it, which is fine. All right, well, I guess I didn't have to wait very long for a Pilgrim. I could take a Blightbreath Cataleptus, which I actually like, but it doesn't look optimized for this deck since we're so heavy in white. Minion's Return has actually performed better than I thought it would as well, but yeah, I like Heliod's Pilgrim here. It basically is a second, like it's another way to get Dreadful Apathy. And that's nice. Oh, here's a Mogus's Favor. I mentioned that I thought that card had overperformed, so we'll take one here. Same with Sentinel's Eyes, though. This does not look like a great Sentinel's Eyes deck. I'm not super into that. I'd much rather have this. The question here is, do I want Karametra's Blessing or Nyxborn Marauder? And I think I'm going to go with the Marauder, actually. I'm a little low on beef here. That's only my 8th creature, so. Soul Reaper of Mogus, fine. I guess I'll take the card draw spell. There's a lot of these flying around, but yeah, I'll take Funeral Rites. And then there's just nothing anymore. I don't think I want fruit. First Sentinel's Eyes or first Leonin of the Lost Pride. Probably just need a creature. Plume, sword, and a little flyer. Okay. Well, I have to say that pack went very, very well for us. We got a good removal spell and two really solid rares. Not bombs, right? These aren't the game enders that you hope for. But they're really good. I mean, these are top tier value cards. Kanoros, very difficult to deal with. And Ephemia, really good too. All right, we've got Thassa Deep Dwelling. Interesting. And remember, over here, we do have a Temple of Enlightenment and a Traveler's Amulet. So if we decided that this was the card we needed for our deck, we could put it in there. And I'm looking at the rest of the pack, and there's some medium stuff. Hero of the Winds and other Chimera are fine. Doxos, fine. But not really. Oh, I did not mean to take that. Well, I accidentally took Doxos, but at least I could have accidentally taken something worse. I don't know how that happened. I thought the mouse was down here. Anyway, whatever. We ended up taking Doxos. I think that would have been my third pick out of that pack. I think I would have taken... If I decided not to take... what's her name? Thassa. Then I might have taken Doxos or another Daybreak Chimera. So... As it stands, we got super lucky. We just got past Archon of Sun's Grace, which is fantastic. Just an awesome card. And yeah, we just got lucky. So that was sweet. Now Sentinel's Eyes looks good. Flicker of Fate, also something to consider. And even Glory Bears. Basically, you want to be able to trigger Constellation with this repeatedly. And, you know, Sentinel's Eyes, Flicker of Fate, and Glory Bears are all cards that can do it, including Soul Reaper, I should mention here as well, because it is an enchantment itself. I'm going to take Glory Bears here, I think. Yeah, I'm going to take that. I don't know if I need... Oh, my God. Dream Trawler. I can't, right? There's just no way. I have the dual land and I do have a Traveler's Amulet, but getting that second blue is just almost impossible, I think. I didn't pick up the 3-mana Mana Rock either, the Pantheon thing. Whoa, I'm so sorry, Dream Trawler. I love you so much. So the question is, do I want Mogus's Favor or Triumphant Surge? Or Brine Giant, but I don't... Or never mind, I'm not in that. Mogus's Favor is better for triggering Constellation, obviously, because it's an enchantment and it's one that we can get back. The downside here is that I've already got one and I don't have a good removal spell at 4 to like kill big stuff. Yeah, I'll take the Triumphant Surge. Oh, we got Reverend Hoplite. Lucky. Lucky, lucky. We are very heavy white. And that's the kind of card that can really give you a big payoff for that. All right, nothing to take here. Let's take the rare, the foil rare. Indomitable Will. Lampad of Vigil's Death. Death Vigil. I should take that. I could also take Flicker of Fate, but I've already got one. So yeah, I'll take this. That's another enchantment creature. All right, see, and look, we're getting these back anyway, so... And there's another one in this pack somewhere, too, so I'm not actually worried about that. I suppose it's not even that bad if, like, I play Mogus's Favor... Let's say I played on a 1-toughness creature and kill it, and then just Ephemia it away. Like, if I've got another one floating around, it's hard to get two going at the same time, so that works. And if I do end up getting a really late Sentinel's Eyes, I'll just grab that, too. I'm a little torn on this Nyxborn Marauder... It's double black is really sketchy in this thing, but it is a creature that's also an enchantment, so you know it's just kind of good. But I don't know. I've got Glory Bears that probably serves that role just fine. Okay, well, there's another Indomitable Will. That's my second one, but they are quite good in this deck, so there's a chance I could run both, I suppose. Like, I could cut the Birth of Miletus, for example. This one actually does just go to the graveyard on its own, though, right? That's actually pretty good, too. Yeah, lots of good synergies here. Ooh, bingo. There's that Sentinel's Eyes. Might even want one. Like maybe one of those over an Indomitable Will or something like that. Just for the repeat factor for our, really our best card, Archon of Sun's Grace. Card is dim. Man, if there's a blue-white drafter at this table and they got Dream Trawler like 6th or something, they're just going to be like, oh my god. What if I just had taken, like looking back, what if I had just taken it and just ran like these two and like some of these junky cards and just been like, whatever, it's worth it. Because my black cards are just okay, right? Like, I've got two really good ones with Kernoros and Ephemia, but the rest are just, like, magic cards. I think you could make an argument that if I could, if I knew the rest of the pack or whatever, that I would rather have the Dream Trawler rather than these black cards. I don't know if that's actually true, but I think it's an argument at least. Okay, so what am I doing here? I've got 14 creatures. I don't think I want Leonin of the Lost Pride. It just doesn't do enough. Pilgrim, yes. I could see cutting Captivating Unicorn and just calling it a deck. Like just running it like this. I could also see running it and cutting like one of the Mogus's Favor. The Birth of Miletus could go. But I think I'm going to leave it like this. This is kind of a sweet build, actually. Should I run Temple of Enlightenment as a tapped scryland, a tapped plains that scries? It's close. I think not, though. This deck looks like it wants to just hit its drops. I think I actually am going to go with 9 here. Yeah, it could get slightly awkward. This could just be a 10-7. Let's see. Combine them. Sort by color. So these are all, we have enough black cards here. That's a lot of black cards. I still could see 10-7. We only need one swamp. So let's do that. All right, so there's our deck. Black-white. Got some nice pack 2 and pack 3 opens there to help us along, and we'll see if we can make this thing work. I want to remind you that this video is brought to you by Channel Fireball, so if you need anything from Theros Beyond Death or any other Magic set, make sure you check them out at channelfireball.com. Let's get into the games. All right. We're on the draw. Yeah, this is an easy keep. So this is a great Shatter the Sky hand. Like, we don't have anything else to do anyway, but if our opponent just sort of plays a few creatures, we can get a 2-for-1 or maybe even a 3-for-1 out of the deal. While we're kind of dirtling around with this nonsense. So your opponent's not going to do much. They're just going to play literally nothing? Guess I can accept that. All we're doing is just drawing a bunch of lands anyway. And now they're just going to start missing land drops, too? What is going on? Okay. I guess I'll just do nothing. I'll just make them do something. Okay, there's a Flummoxed Cyclops. I'm just going to play this out. And I've got Indomitable Will that I can use to pump it to 5 toughness. So, for example, if they go for Eros's Blessing, I can protect and put myself in a very good position. Because this thing's impossible to race. I also could go for the surprise block here. But that feels kind of bad, so I'm just not going to. It just feels risky. It opens me up to some stupid combat tricks that I could lose both cards, like +2/+0 on first strike, and all of a sudden I just lose my whole thing. And when my opponent has six cards in hand and they're all spells, we know that they're all spells, I think it's better just to wait. Perforos. Okay, that's not very good. It's a good draw. So Triumphant Surge actually deals with the Flummox Cyclops kind of cleanly here. So my opponent can start putting stuff into play, but they lose it at their end step, so it's like very short-term style thing. They want to exile this idiot. Yeah, that's fine. Kill this. Okay. Yeah, we're in a good spot. You have an Arena Trickster. I guess I'll just take one more hit from it in the hopes that they cast another creature. If not, I can just shatter this guy to 1/1 for the Trickster. It's not the end of the world. So they'll get a card back off of this, so it ends up being an even money trade, but it kind of resets them. Drawing a creature wouldn't be the all-time worst either. I've only drawn one somehow. Two, I suppose. Right, that counts. And I can just kind of empty out my hand here as well. I was ready for that. Creatures? Yes. Oh, baby. That definitely counts. Does putting Amogus' favor on this change my clock? 5, 10, 15. It does, but I don't actually need to. I can do it once. I can go 5, 10, and then hit for 7. So I don't need to do it now. So I'm just going to attack. Heck yes, I would. That's my clock, by the way, only with this card. As it stands, I've got a lot more than that going on. So, can Mogus's favor... So, this thing is going to make this... Untap it, 4/4, and indestructible. Well, if that's the case, I can just jam here. This won't let me kill my opponent now, but it will let me kill them next turn. Yeah, see, look, that's the card I played. Wow, I'm playing around everything, and it's actually like my opponent has had everything. Kind of funny. Yeah, I'm just going to exile this Mogus's favor. That's fine. Right. We ground them out. And by the way, one of the cards that probably won us that game was actually Purphoros. That did not very much right there. Now we're playing against aggressive red-white. Is there anything else that we want here? Maybe another Indomitable Will. These instant speed pump spells that stick around are pretty good against these decks. Let's try it. Okay, I'll keep this one. Card draw, powerful card, some card advantage. Like, I like it. This could have been a Plains, and I would have been a little happier, but so it goes. Phoenix, all right. Let's get the Pilgrim down here. And we'll look to Dreadful Apathy, the Phoenix of Ash, because it's the kind of card that just keeps coming back over and over and will kill you at some point. We'll apathize this. I think this is a free attack here, right? My opponent has seen that we have Mogus's favor and probably just is going to want to take the one damage. rather than lose their envoy. Oh. Interesting. So they decided, that's interesting. I don't think that was really about killing the pilgrim. It must just be that their game plan is to make a 3-2 flyer and beat me down with it. And just hope I don't have a removal spell, basically. Yikes. All right, now they got 5 power in the air. We're forced to dig here because we are in bad, bad shape. I can go to 1. Well, I think we're just going to lose this game, so I may as well see what's going on here. They've got another Revoke, a Nyxborn Brute, and an Arena Trickster. But yeah, we're just going to lose. Very aggressive beat down here. Maybe I'll bring in the 1-3 flyer just to block this. Maybe if we draw our Pegasus, we could win. Like, even if they pump, we go to 1. We go Plains, Pegasus, have Indomitable Will to make a flyer, and it's a lifelinker. I think we could probably win that, actually. What? I was tapped out. You just had the win that whole time. Gross. Let's see if we would have drawn it. No, it was Flicker. All right. So, yeah, do I want this thing? I think so, actually. We'll do it like that. So, yeah, I guess really, I really just like to see Archon of Sun's Grace at some point here and build around getting, like, a bird off of it or something. That would probably be pretty good. I mean, if it survives, we win this matchup kind of easy. But, you know, they'll use anything they can to kill it. Would like to play first. All right, there's my Archon. Oh, this is a sweet draw. I get to go rare into rare. I was hoping to be able to do something else, but I guess I'll settle right now for land. Okay, they got the Phoenix, but no answer for this as of yet. Yuck. These are probably our two best cards, but it is going to be extremely difficult to win if we literally just draw lands for the rest of the game. Because likely one of these is going to get answered here in some fashion. no way I'm blocking here. I can attack back and gain a ton of life, and if I expose this to aspect of Manticore, it's just a disaster. Like, I don't even gain the life. So I think they're just going to sack it to kill our Archon. That's actually a pretty good draw. I get a couple or three things, and that's just a lot of things to make into 4/4. So it means that they really do need to kill this. And they did. Sort of. That's annoying. Mm-hmm. I wonder if I just go for the quad block here. They get to kill these three or one and one. I guess I just take it. I'd rather get rid of the Nyxborn guy. Ooh. That's interesting. So if I do this, they get a card back. Yeah, I don't think I need to right now. I can just force a little more action here, like triple block this or something. And they'll probably use Aspect of Manticore on it. And then I can shatter. That actually worked. Okay. Well, in order to win the game, they're going to have to play another creature then. I guess that's kind of the idea here. Oh, that was bad. I didn't do the thing. Crap. I just kind of had it in my head that I was going to shatter, but now I can actually just not. Awkward. Should I play Heliod's Pilgrim? I could play both of these. Like, I could Wrath and then play Heliod's Pilgrim and then get like a removal spell. It doesn't seem really great though. We'll see if I actually get to use this again. This would have been the turn that I got to do so. Not use it this turn, but use it the next turn. But I'm just wondering if I need to just fire off the Wrath here. Let's see what we draw. A Plains, awesome. 2, 3, 4, 5 probably I could take if they have the aspect. I guess I just pass here. I feel like I'm going to lose to this Phoenix. how am I going to beat that? Because they're going to bring it back and then pump it up a couple of times and just kill me with it. Oh my God. I can't take it. So what does this thing cost? It costs four, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and then they could pump it once and it comes back with the counter. So it's three, so it's five, so I would not lose to it, and then I could theoretically do things. So I think I just battle. Do this. Do this. Get my insurance plan and pass. So if they bring it back, they can get me to two, but then I can Dreadful Apathy it, so it's like kind of awkward for them. We just don't have choices with how many lands we've got here. Yep. Yep. I'm down to two. Is there any haste creatures that could kill us? So, go ahead. All right, maybe they're out of gas. Ooh, hello. Okay. And kill them in two turns here. 2, 4, 5, 2, 4, 5. They're dead. Hold. Oh, wow. Wow, we barely won. Oh, my God. You're like 11 lands. And we did have our two best spells, so it kind of did something, but one of them died. Wow. I'm surprised we won that, to be honest, given the amount of lands, and I missed that trigger thing and all that. Well, we got away with one, so up a match. All right, is this a keep? Yeah, I think it actually is. It's a little clunky with this stuff, but if things go horribly awry, we could get back in the game after hitting our fourth land there with Shatter. And we get to play some spells before that happens. Which one is this? Green, red? Okay. These type of cards are typically pretty good against green, red. Just kind of raw toughness cards. As it stands, we can put this lamp pad, get this thing going. All Well, now we need to find one of our Mogus's favor. Ooh. That's a nice one. Okay, I'm just going to pass here. I can use Indomitable Will to eat an attacker. I'm questioning whether I want to, and I think I don't. I think I don't want this in the yard, actually, because it's a good way to kill this later on. All right, well, now we just want a Wrath. Plains? Huh, yeah, baby. That's the one. They'll get one card out of it. Bye-bye, Sky. So now the key interaction here is that if we're going to play this Archon, we need to make sure that it doesn't just die to Chainweb Arachnir. Oh, that was pretty good. Which needs four other cards, so it actually isn't likely to... That is not likely to happen here. So we'll just run out this thing. They have to come up with a bunch of cards in the yard and the mana and everything, so I think we're in okay shape here. And they don't get to make any more guys. Oh, and look at that. We found our own. And now this is going to actually be safe as well because we've got Indomitable Will. Scrying, okay. Wow, this is just an absurdly good turn for us. Holy smokes. We get another Pegasus here. We get to exile this to make a zombie, and we get to leave up Indomitable Will just for value. All right, finally, they had something to interact, but we still get this. So that's pretty good. But we did kind of have our fun. And they did actually get an omen. So this turn basically accomplished getting this Pegasus big enough to not get hit by Chainweb because my opponent didn't even do the thing so that they know that that's what they're going to try to do. So instead they have to kill this Pegasus. But then this sets us up down the line for what's her name? Because for our own Aphemia to kind of take over again. Even though this will brick wall this particular attack, at least at the moment. So we cast our own Aphemia here. And just pass. we'll see what we get. So it still doesn't quite enable an attack. I can make this thing into a 4-6 when it attacks, but it still just gets blocked by the chain web Arachnir, so we have to wait. Not bad. Not a bad thing to lead into the Reverent Hoplite either, but it doesn't actually get us ahead on board at the moment. Basically, we need to find an answer for the Arachnir, and then we can just start slamming. And in the meantime, I believe that the Reverent Hoplite will keep the ground stable enough for us to not die to, you know, random things like this. And we may even be able to just attack for lethal next turn. We'll do the math. Okay, so if we attack with everything, they got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 creatures, which blocks 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of those, and they take 7, but then they also can throw off the math with this. So no, it is not a good all-in attack here. Even though they do lose some stuff in the process, they also get to eat up some of our creatures. So yeah, I think it's just not quite there. So I'm just going to pass again. It's all about finding a removal spell. It's not bad. But they don't really have a ton of expendable stuff at this point, so it's not amazing or anything. But we just keep drawing land, so I guess it doesn't matter. Yep. They are down to 0 cards. This thing has gotten completely huge. Man, this deck has been floody. I think it's just nothing about the deck particularly. We just happen to have been drawing a good amount of lands. Our opponent has 2, to be fair. That's a good draw for them. So now they can start activating that twice a turn or even 3 times and filling it up to get stuff for Euphemia. I'm just going to take this, actually. Oh, come on. Yeah, see, look, they already hit. That's not an enchantment. Boy, this game is very close to us being able to win it, but these lands have made it just like much, much less likely. I'm going to throw a triple block on this or something. Three, six, like that. And then I'll just throw one of these here just to not take a big hit. So they get to kill three things, like two that don't matter and one that does, or they can kill one big thing and one little thing. They're trying to not put this in the yard because it makes me a zombo. Come on, deck. Oh, my God. This is just misery. I don't know what this means. Beetle is viable? What are they trying to say? You can't target the beetle, right? It's not enchanted, or it's not, and it's not an enchantment. Yeah, I'm not really sure what they were talking about there. Okay, well. What does a win even look like at this point? I guess it's dreadful apathy. Get rid of this thing. They can just sack it, but that's fine. And start hitting with this. I think it's just this guy. They didn't bother moving the wings. I wonder why. Maybe they could just kill me. Yeah, they could have just killed me, like, easily, right? They hit me for 12 and then just sack four things and I'm dead. Huh. Maybe they'll do it this time. Or maybe that's what they were talking about. I don't know what the bug is. But yeah, I'm not winning this game. I just have no way out. This is where Shatter of the Sky could be a thing, but I don't have one. All right, I'm just going to pass here. I mean, honestly, my opponent could have killed me two turns ago. Now I'm going to jam with most things. Oh, just this guy? I think they just forgot about this for a while and probably will remember now. Oh, what can I do? What can I do? I don't think there's a lot I can change here. No, I think we had a very fair chance to win that game, but that middle chunk of the game where we just drew land or whatever just devastated us. Like, we were very close to being able to slam the door on that thing. We just had to either overwhelm or get rid of that Arachnir, and we just couldn't. Got to mulligan that one. Yeah, this is a keeper. Having one of these is nice in case they have the 2-1 flyer again, just to be able to snap it off. What do I not want here? Glory Bearers? I think so. Funeral Rites. That's a really good draw. Yeah, I'm really happy to see that. It gives us something to do next turn where we can kind of go off. I assume no block here, so I can just get in. All right. We did not hit a land, but we moved our game plan forward. And we will guarantee to hit a land next turn if we don't draw one. If we do, I'll probably do this or something like that, depending on how things go. So here's a question. Do I want to play Shatter of the Sky? I think the answer is no. a little awkward because I'm giving my opponent an extra card by doing so, but I think it's not the worst plan, actually. Drain you a little bit. Doesn't feel like the best way to get ahead here, but these are going to kill me, so I'm just going to fire it off. So it's not the worst, right? They only draw the one card. I'm trying to set up a scenario where I can play Archon and make sure I get some value out of it in case it dies immediately. I want to do Dreadful Apathy on whatever they play next, exile it, get it in the yard, play Lagana Band Storyteller, get it back, play it on something else. That's kind of my game plan here. Relentless Pursuit, they get Soul Reaper and Nylea's Intervention. All right, well, they have an answer for Archon. Does that actually go in their hand? No, that goes there. Okay, so they got Soul Reaper, that's in the yard, and like a forest. Okay. The wings are in the yard too. Okay. This is actually pretty good then, because I can go like this and just get rid of that thing. That was a little weird. This is probably worth killing. Right now it's not doing much, but it can. Though right now it's really just not doing that much. So I'll just do this. I should have attacked with this, actually. I didn't want them to animate a land and then just eat it, but I think it would have been fine. Because I could have put the 2 damage on and then gotten it. All right, what are they getting back? The Marauder. That's the best thing. Okay. I guess it does add an extra enchantment for this. Do they have an enchantment? Yeah. All right, it's a pretty good turn. Works for me. So they got to have an answer for Archon, but they probably do. Oh, I was wrong. They don't. Now they're going to try to hit the Arachnir here. Funny. So let's attack with everything. Kill that. I don't actually care about that card so much, but I do care about getting an extra flyer in the air. All right. So we found the win there because our flyer survived, basically. All right, this is an easy keep. In fact, this is just a really, really great hand. Wow. Yeah, this hand is amazing. I get to Agonizing Remorse to clear the way for a bomb or a removal spell and then cast back-to-back rares. So they got Soul Reaper, Relentless Pursuit, and Nessian Boar. Well, this boar actually is a pretty big issue for us, so I'm going to have to take it away, I guess. Like, if we had an answer for it, it would be fine, but if my plan is just to play kind of big dummies, it's going to be a real issue. But as it stands, I am in a good position here, no doubt. Wow. How many rares can I have? I guess the answer is all of them. Still, my opponent's draw is fine, too. This is by no means over. Ooh, oh, they did hit a land. They hit a land and this. Wow, that's really good. Good news is that this exiles, so they don't get back the boar, but yeah, that was really nice for them. Double vigilance. So right now, the only permanent they have to get back is this, so they'll have to mill something sweet. At any rate, they get value. It's not like it's not value. It's just not, you know, amazing. Horn beetle? Okay. 2/4. I guess that is a thing. Ooh, flicker of fate. So that lets me like keep this alive, like I can attack and still keep it alive, keep the damage flowing, or I could just attack with this. No targets for this yet, but I only play rares apparently. Okay, I got them down to 7 here, but we're in a precarious position, no doubt about it. Them finding that final death was pretty clutch. Oh, now they can get Renata or Soul Reaper. But the key here is that we continue to keep bashing with this or that we find like a spell. They got Grove Dancer. All right, they know what they need. I guess I can just do this. Because this lets me get Mogus's Favor in the graveyard anyway. One way or another. Three more turns, but it is going to be really difficult. They're trying to find their spider. Ah, this is extremely annoying. There's Nyx Herald. I mean, I can't really complain about our draw. Like, we had all these rares and stuff, but again, we're just so close and just finding lands. That is not really what we need either, to be honest. Well, they still haven't been able to find what they need. That's the only good news. Aphemia, no. And not lands, but they're going to hit. It's going to be three more turns before we can kill them. That's the issue here. And we drew a two drop. And that is a dryad and a forest. They're back up to two. Yeah, the things that need to happen for us to dodge the bullet here are very narrow. Yeah, so they hit the swamp, so they already got that. Now, right now, I'm still actually ahead enough, although this does throw the math off. But this is the put land cards in your hand one. All right. Spell? Nope. Certainly not. What happens if I just attack with everything? This bounces off of this. This gets eaten. This bounces off of this. This gets eaten. So nothing good. All right. Because I kind of want Daxos to die, like, for value, so I can get a 2-2 out of it and then, you know, continue to chip away at their board. But as it stands, I can't actually do anything. Unbelievable. And then there they hit the chain web arachnir. So they finally get to take care of Aphemia. And hilariously, Aphemia hasn't really... She's made a couple of zombies, but they haven't been super relevant. It's really just been a matter of attacking for two in the air over and over again. And now they have six cards left in their library, and they have to get us from 27 to 0. Well, it's not impossible by any stretch of the imagination, but if we draw spells, I like our chances. But if we keep doing this, I think we will lose, which is kind of incredible. Yeah, I just have to take a hit from this because it can just keep coming back anyway. All right, Mogus's Favor. What does this do? Attack with everything. Everything must be blocked. So it does allow me to pick off something on their side, but not meaningfully. So I'm just going to have to pass. Wow, this draw. Incredible. I drew three rares in a row, basically. Incredible opener. And then the rest has been one drops, two drops, and lands. All right, this is a 3-3. It makes a 3-3. That's pretty good, actually. And it can make two of them. And they're just toss away lands anyway, so it's like, whatever. Yeah, we're going to get ran over here. Incredible. I think we're going to need to find the Wrath to win. Oh, they didn't make any? That's strange. I do gain a bunch of life here, though, so that's a thing. Could be worse. If we draw the sweeper, I think we just win. They're down to three cards, but that's actually plenty enough given the way that the board's played out. But they really need to start using this. I don't know why they're not using it. Like, they could just 6, 7, 8, they could just make 2 things and just start killing us with them. All right, well, let's try to get rid of this beetle. Because we have entered desperation time now. Where we're going to need to have some really good top decks here to get out of this. Huh. That does count. That was exactly what we needed to see. Also, they have a power. They have to sacrifice this so that they don't draw the card. Yeah, they're just going to give up. Wow, what an incredible game. What a weird and incredible game. All right, that was sweet. Let's go to the last one and see if we can't get this trophy. All right, how does this look? This looks very good. Rare, rare, uncommon. You know the deal. Ephemia is just sweet, too. Just a good card. Wow. This curve. We get to play 3 rares. Turn 2, turn 3, turn 4, rare. That's absurd. Against blue white. No attack here. Don't want to trade off for the envoy. And we get to start slamming hard next turn here. Attack for 7. And my opponent needs to put out something that can get in the way of this. You'll see if they have a dreadful apathy for this. Not quite. It's Heliod's Punishment. Which is much worse. Because that means that at some point we'll get this thing back. This curve. Unbelievable. And I'm loving it too. Now just give me some enchantments and I'll be happy. Riptide Turtle, sure. You did it. So if they have an answer for the Archon of Sun's Grace, and we have a plan here, but like that'll sufficiently hold us back. I mean, as much as these are all sweet rares and everything like that, they're just creatures. Like this can just happen, right? Where they can just lock them up or do things against them. So, yeah, you know, we're in there. We're fighting the fight. But ultimately, this is still a situation of... like, our average power level for these cards is way higher than they would be if they were commons or even uncommons. But this is not win the game, right? Just for existing level stuff here, right? This is, you got to do a little more. All right, so this is interesting. Mogus's Favor. I could put it on this and make this into a 3-1. That doesn't really do anything. And the Naiad of Hidden Coves, it doesn't really do anything there. So I think I'm just going to wait. And just keep walking up the hill, as it were, with these 2 Heliod's Punishments. Heliod's Punishment's an interesting card. I don't know where my opponent's going with this exactly. Oh, and by the way, I'm not playing this because it just gets blocked anyway, and I want to get value out of it if one of these things ends up dying. Generally speaking, Heliod's Punishment shines in aggressive decks where the amount of time that the creature is locked out of combat, because that is all it does, right? It loses all abilities and gets this ability, right? So it takes it out of combat. It's its primary role. But you need to be beating down in the meantime, right? Like, you got to get rowdy. And if you don't, well, like, this is going to happen, right? Like, I'm starting to actually tick down. Now, they have finally put up a bit more of a force here, but still, it's still not super impressive, and I may be able to actually get out of this. So let's play this. And right now, I don't think there's anything that I actually want to sacrifice, so we'll just sort of continue on our merry way here. But, you know, there's an argument to be made, for example, to sacrifice this to itself to get a thing, if that ends up, you know, because I get a card out of the deal as well. Sure. I'm just going to take the hits here. The fact is, I have ways to gain some life and gain some more life here, so it should work out well. I'd love to see a target for Mogus's Favor be actually good, though we haven't seen that quite yet. So two more on that, one more on that. This, of course, is the key. If my opponent does have an answer to that, then we could lose. I mean, it's not impossible. So I could attack with this, but they're just going to block with this. So I'm just going to step back here, or just going to ship it back here, I should say. So now they can return Heliod's Punishment, but they have to target this one because I can make this one go away at instant speed, right? It's any enchantment. One other target enchantment. So what's their best target? It is just these punishments, but they'd have to unleash this beast at least for a turn. So I'm just going to say okay here. And since they decided to attack, that thing won't be able to block. Oh, is it the beginning of your upkeep? Oh, sweet. So they actually don't get to move any of them. For some reason, I thought it was end step. Nice. That's pretty good. So Heliod's Pilgrim means that I'm actually going to just activate this ahead of time here. Because I want to get the... is there anything worth... It's kind of interesting. I could actually take the second Mogus's Favor, and I could double Mogus's Favor, the Shimmerwing Chimera, which would kill it and get me two 2/2 flyers in the process. No, darn it. Okay, I'll get one flyer in the process because... I needed to do that first. So, loose. I guess I leave... These can both attack. This has vigilance anyway, and this gets untapped. Interestingly, I actually could untap this just to have it untapped as a blocker. It would mean less damage coming in. Oh, what happened? Man, what is going on here? I don't know what I must have just clicked wrong there. I was actually going to untap this just because I want to have as much as I can to block. Not that I need it. I mean, I'm in a pretty good position here with this. This thing has lifelink. But as you can see, it would have been nice to have my Archon untapped here. As it stands, I get to survive this attack, and this looks like I'm in a very good position now. Because now I get to start rumbling here, and I think I can just attack with basically everything, I suppose. This and this can get blocked. Like, this zombie can just get eaten, and this can get hit. So I guess I don't need to attack with those. So I just attack with everything else, basically. I guess I do it to this one. This is a better blocker, but I don't actually want to risk it in combat. And this gets me an additional point of lifelink. I get 4, 5, 6, 7. If I do this one, I get 6. So I actually gain 1 extra life. If this gets to connect, then I'm in good shape because I gain so much extra life. All right, so now I'm back up to 10 and I can kind of breathe a sigh of relief here. Do I want to cast Lagonaban Storyteller? And do I want to exile this to make it into a zombie? I think the answer is definitely yes here. And I think it's questionable here, but probably also a yes. Like, at this point, I should just probably full court press and just try to kill my opponent next turn. That said, I'm so far ahead, I don't really need to do that. I'm assuming they're going to finally stop attacking. And this can allow me to buy back this if it dies. This sort of, but I mean, I probably wouldn't. Yeah, I'll just wait. And I will exile this though. Yeah, this game's going to go another few turns. I've still got a little bit of work to do here. But the cool part is that by cashing in these and turning these into zombies, I can start drawing extra cards too. Like, I could just sack this and this or whatever and just turn them into cards. Okay. So they're playing a lot of flyers. Is there anything? I could bring in this dork, which blocks the 2-3, not the 3-3, and the 1-2. That's got to be better than something, right? Than some mediocre card. Like, this card's probably pretty bad in this matchup, for example. If there's just a bunch of flyers, then the 0-4 loses a lot of value. And in order for this card to be, you know, good enough, you kind of need it to do everything. Like, the life has to matter, the 0-4 needs to block, the planes has to matter, and the fact that it's an enchantment entering the battlefield and going to the graveyard. Kind of, you need at least that to touch all of that. And, you know, if the 0-4 doesn't block anything relevant for a game, it probably is better just to have it be a 1-3 flyer. Oh, no, we have to play Fair Magic now? Well, I better play a little tighter if that's the case. Very slow hand here. Probably just going to lead with the familiar here. What do you got? Ooh, staggering insight. If that's the case, then let's just play the familiar, because that effectively brick walls my opponent's plan to just go staggering and start inside and start drawing a bunch of cards. So they're going to play a flyer instead, it looks like. And my Indomitable Will actually do pretty good work here. But unfortunately, I do have to kind of skip my turn to play it this time just because of awkwardness. But they're going to windmill this on here, I bet. No? All right, well, I'll just go for this. Shimmerwing with no targets. All right, I'm just going to play the Pilgrim here then. Go get Apathy. And now I'm just going to pass. And then I can use Flicker of Fate to kind of mess with things. Like I can either Flicker the Pilgrim to go get, you know, one of my one mana enchantments. Or if they try to get one of my creatures out of the way, I can, like, if they try to get this out of the way, I could flicker it. Now, it sucks because Indomitable will fall off, but I could block still in that scenario or whatever. All right, so they're going to go for this now, but I have the block. Okay, I can also exile this and just knock that off of there. But I think it's okay to just not do anything for the turn. What is going on here, though? Because they know I have this Dreadful Apathy. So do I just get to do this? Ah, I'm going to get countered. Okay. All right. Well, I mean, I'm still just kind of here doing my thing. By the way, this guy's been an all-star holding off both of those. Take a hit from this, but this is really the issue. Like taking that much damage plus the lifelink plus the cards flowing would just be kind of death for us. And so we're facing down something real here, but I think we can deal with it. So let's get Kanuros down because this helps us race. And then do I just want to run Storyteller out? It actually has attacks here, and I don't think I'm getting anything better like into the graveyard anytime soon. So yeah, I'll just run it out there. And we'll just try to race, basically. I'm just going to do that so I don't forget. Because game one, I played pretty loose, and I just want to make sure I don't... Like, I'm tapped out. I can't represent, you know, another one of these or some other trick. So, Lifelink and Vigilance, jam with the squad. Makes sense. Let's see what we draw. Ooh, Mogus's Favor. All right, well, I guess I can just go for the hoplite here in case something dies. So I can get a bunch of this. And then I guess I can just start jamming with this. I mean, they can double block and I just have to trade off, but that's not, I think I can live with that. Because this guy's going to come back and block this at some point. Do I send in the Heliod's Pilgrim? No, I don't think so. Okay, they've got Riptide Turtle. So I guess they go block, block on this, and then just block this. Oh, they're just going to take it. All right. Well, I think I'm good with that because my Kunoros is, it has lifelink. So it's just going to be tough for them to race. Heliod's Punishment. On this? Oh, they returned it to their hand. Fair. This thing's going to be out of the game forever. Okay, I get it. And they're just going to try to race. He's walking uphill. That's awkward. So I can do some weird stuff. I could Mogus's Favor this and then kill it with this. I could do that to any of these creatures. I feel like this is the best one because it takes away their flexibility there. That's probably what I have to do. If that's the case, though, I am getting absolutely rowdy here. The only attacker on the ground is this that I would open up. So I'll attack like that. Give it lifelink. Oh, boy, they have a counter, don't they? So I go back up to 7. Oh, they're going to give a lifelink. Okay, sweet. So that actually is much better for us because now we know that this goofy play is going to actually go through. And back on the treadmill for this guy. Okay. Yeah, I mean, this thing is beating us down pretty good. Back down to 5. Oof, that's brutal. Another creature enters a battlefield or dies. All right, so let's play him in case something dies. Which I can make that happen, actually, by Mogus's favoring one of my one drops. Or my one toughness creatures, or this thing. Hanging on by a thread. I think we're going to need to get lucky here, though. Very close. The Heliod's punishment on Cunoros was clutch. Kind of just one turn either way. GG. All right, so I like our game plan of our sideboard plan there. That worked out well. And I don't really see much else that we can do along those lines, so let's just run it back and have one turn difference there. One more hit with Cunoros or one more way to... One more turn to, you know, get the Heliod. I mean, one turn is usually a big difference in a game of Magic. But that is what we needed. Yeah, this looks good. Probably want to save Sentinel's Eyes for the Thaumaturge's Familiar as it makes it an excellent blocker. And we kind of know what the game plan is for our opponent, so saving Dreadful Apathy for one of their two or three powered flyers seems reasonable. Ooh. I'm going to actually go for this. Let's just see what they're up to and take them off their plan, because getting Aphemia down is nice as a 2-1 flyer, but it's proven that it's not really going to be getting through all that much, so... All right, deny the divine, thirst for meaning, or a transcendent envoy with land. So this is a pretty bad hand for our opponent, all told. I think I'm going to take thirst for meaning. Because this is their way to reload. Transcendent envoy is mediocre, doesn't even get through Thaumaturge's Familiar. And deny the divine, well, it's going to get something, but they have to leave the mana up, and us knowing that it's there makes it significantly worse. Like, this next turn, I get to just resolve the Thaumaturge's Familiar, for example. And so their attacker is Brickwalled. Awesome. Now, the interesting part about this is that given what we know in their hand, they're very likely to just leave up Deny the Divine because they don't have anything else to do unless they top decked it, which is kind of funny. And that's fine. We can just not cast this. There's nothing wrong with that. And in fact, I think we're just going to not cast anything. Perfect. It's funny. I was thinking about what kind of card I wanted to draw here, and this was exactly the type of card I wanted to draw. Like a four drop that is fine, but... They don't really want it on the battlefield, but they also don't really want to spend the counterspell on it. That is exactly what we wanted. So that is the perfect draw for this juncture because we could start beating down with it. Now we're just ahead. Okay, so they had the answer for this. And I'll just pass. Let's get the beatdown rolling. Perfect. More turtles doesn't really do anything here. And we've built up a lot of mana, so if the shields ever go down, we're going to be able to go like Archon plus Aphemia make a 2-2 flyer or Archon plus Dreadful make a 2-2 flyer, something like that. Sure. So this is one that if it gets countered, I'm fine. And it does need to get countered. So now we're probably going to see them untap and just start slamming whatever they've had in their hand this whole time. Like that. That's interesting too. So what's the plan here? I can go Archon, Ephemia, go. They can bounce, return the Heliod's punishment to their hand and start doing things. Alternatively, I could just go Dreadful Apathy, exile it, and just get rid of that loop and that creature, which is pretty good. I think I'm going to do that, actually. And part of my reasoning for that is that I drew Lagana Band Storyteller, which is a card I can use to get back Dreadful Apathy later as well, so I can still cast it. All right, I'm just going to go for the removal here. I feel like they have some way to interact here, but as long as the Dreadful Apathy ends up in my hand or in my graveyard and they don't have anything insane, I'm fine with it. Yeah, so that's what happened. So they did return it that time, so we're going to see it cast again. It's a good combo. But we got combos too. And I'm not going to use this ability this time because I want to Storyteller it back, cast it, get a bird, exile a thing, get it in the graveyard, and then turn it into a zombie. I want full value. So what they're going to have to do here is put it on the Archon so that I don't, so that the ability goes away. But this is just going to make life very difficult for them because I am going to go for this play now. And if I draw this next turn, cast it, and put it on this and actually get rid of it, then this is going to end at some point. And that's kind of the key here. I guess returning it doesn't do anything for this one round because I can just, if they put it back on, I just do it anyway. Oh my God, really? No, anything but that. So, is this card beatable? Sort of. Realistically, no, but we actually do happen to have the type of board that could beat it because we could just simply put out enough cards to block it. I mean, that's kind of the main deal here. This is obviously not going to work, but I need to get through as many of their, oh my God, is it going to work? That actually worked. Wow. So we have them down to this board now, and we're at 16. That's amazing. I kind of can't believe that that just happened. Okay, well, I'm not going to use Sentinel's Eyes just yet. It's tempting because I have a Pegasus here, but I'm still at 16, and I'm taking a total of 2 damage a turn, and in 2 turns, I can Archon and step Archon my turn correctly this time, and then play Sentinel's Eyes, and I'll get a bird out of it, and that's way worth it. Wow, I cannot believe that Dream Trawler hit the battlefield, and I actually just triple blocked and killed it. Oh, good. Good. I was talking about that so much, I forgot to do this. Good. Good. So, why do I keep making these idiotic, like, loose play mistakes? This is so stupid. Thankfully, I didn't get punished for it in game one, and the position I'm in right now, yeah, I'm going to get punished. They're going to go get Dreadful Apathy, and I won't get the bird. So I'm down a... Oh, it's Heliod's punishment? What happens if it has 2? Do I have to work off both of them? Funny. All right, well, we're still very much in this, though. That was definitely a loosey-goosey play. So what's going to happen now, though, is... I am now going to go for Sentinel's Eyes on my... bird or Pegasus. Sorry, I keep saying bird, but it's actually not. And now I can block or even attack, I suppose. Can I? Yeah, I would trade off for that. Would I? Actually, no, I don't think I would actually. Okay. And we get to figure out how this works. If I tap this, is it specific to the Heliod's punishment that I choose, or does it remove it from both? I can't wait to find out. And let's hope I actually remember to tap it this time. It's always a wild ride. All right, remove. It just removed it from this one. Yeah, I have no idea how this works, but whatever. That's a fine draw. That's the other thing, is that I've been drawing so many lands, I just forgot to consider the fact that I could also just draw something, like win the game that way. That actually happens to people sometimes, I'm told. Staggering insight. Shoot, guess I have to take a hit here. Hope to draw a flyer or a removal spell or something. So it just removes it from the one with the highest? I don't get to choose or something? All right, this is a good draw. So now I actually have a block for this. And I get to gain some life back from Kanoros here. Even if he ends up trading off on the ground for, you know, these 2 dirtles or whatever. Oh, I actually get a plus toughness. So he won't trade off for those. It'll have to be all 3 of these. Sweet. I get to kill all of them. 1 for each. Go up to 12. And... yeah, I don't have time to get greedy now, so I just have to put this on here. This card's been impressive. It does just enough. Okay, work off the one with the most debt. Another Mogus's Favor. I guess I save this one. Suppose I can just attack here. It's a lot of damage. So I'm going to see how this works. When I remove the last one, does it just choose at random? And then I remove the next one and it just does the other? Okay, that's fine. We're in good shape. That bird that I didn't get would have been really handy this game. Like, we took 1 hit and a card from Staggering Insight, so that's a 3 damage, 3 life for my opponent, and a card. So that did, that oversight, like, while I was blabbing, definitely hurt. It wasn't the type of thing where like you have the win and then you throw it away, but it was a large setback. That's something I should not have done. All right, so that one goes away. Does this one go away now? Finally get rid of this? I did it. What do I want to do with this Mogus's favor? I want to put it on something. Guess I can attack with this first. It has lifelink. It does not trade off for this. So they're going to have to throw multiple creatures in front if they're going to get it dead. And if they do, I'll have these in the yard so I get to cast them again. So yeah, this works out. Go Pegasus, go. They're going to chump block. I accept. I could put it on here so this thing can actually start attacking. I wonder if there's something that I need to save it for. I guess getting the bird is probably just better than anything else. Or the Pegasus, I'm sorry. I keep saying bird, but... Daybreak Chimera. All right, so they finally found a trade for this thing. And I don't want to make that trade. I'd rather leave it back to block this. Maybe I lied. Maybe I do want to make that trade. If I trade this off, I can just rebuild at least part of this again on this bird. Like the important part. I can give it +2/+1. Yeah, so I'll just do that. And I'm just going to call these birds, by the way. They are no longer Pegasi. They are birds. I'm sorry. So now they're going to trade here. I get Mogus's favor and Sentinel. Sentinel's Eyes into the yard. And I'm going to go with Mogus's favor on the bird. Exiling these two doofs. And that gets me another one as well as the 4/1 lifelinker. Go ahead. Oh, I can actually start attacking with this too. Why don't I do that? Maybe I should like do the things I say I'm going to do. Just a random thought. Not so interested in that one. Okay, so we got him in chump block mode, so that's pretty good. We actually have both drawn the same number of lands. Ooh, that's the kind of card that can kill an opponent quickly. I'll play it here to make sure I get the bird, and then... you know, in case combat needs to get changed around a little bit here. The kind of thing where, like, if they have a removal spell for it or something, then I can just sack it and get the Val. All right, they're going to start throwing these guys away. So the floodgates are going to open very shortly here. I'm still giving this, of course, a lot of respect because it is a type of combo that can swing a game back in the wrong direction. Ooh, Flicker of Fate, too. This can't actually get in because of this. Although I could just flicker that thing. I feel like I'm in a pretty commanding position now, though. If it cleared the way for all of the birds, I'd probably go for it. Really? They're going to deck themselves. Very long match. They discarded Memory Drain. And another Thirst for Meeting. All right. More birds. Your move. Down to four cards. My attacks are not amazing because of this thing now, so I think I'm just going to sit here and do this the good old-fashioned way. Oh, actually, I can start attacking with this, can't I? I didn't even notice that. This is only deals combat damage to a player, right? Yeah. All right, might as well. Because I've got all these guys to block this. So I don't see a lot of downside there. Down to three cards for opponent. We're at 26. I don't think there's any way out at this point for their deck. Seven. I guess I can just draw a card here. Oh, I actually do have a card still. So the truth is that I actually can probably just win this game by doing some sort of alpha strike and then include a whole bunch of sacrifices to this thing and just sort of win this game. But it just doesn't feel like that's the way that, like, I can just sit here. What they're going to try to do here is clock me out, but they just don't have the library to make that work. I'm just going to pass here. Like I said, if we had 20 minutes on the clock or they had 20 cards in their library, then there's a lot of things I would consider differently here. But yeah, that's just not the case. So all I have to do here is block this, but let this thing through because it draws them a card. And when it does so, they lose the game. All right, we did it. We got the trophy. That was sweet. A little loosey-goosey at the end there, but thankfully it was more minor stuff and not strategic stuff. And we were able to get the job done. And win the trophy. That was sweet. The deck was nice, too. That curve out, 2-drop rare, 3-drop rare, 4-drop rare. Again, these weren't the game enders, right? But they were all really strong cards and super awesome to be able to do that. I probably won't get a chance to do that again. I don't know if I've ever had a curve that was all rares, 2, 3, 4. That's pretty sweet. That's going to do it for this one. If you want to find me on social media, I'm Marshall_LR pretty much everywhere. You can find everything related to the podcast I do every week with Luis Scott Vargas called Limited Resources at lrcast.com. And of course, I'll remind you, this video is brought to you by Channel Fireball. So if you want to sell your cards back to them, this is a great thing to do. If you got that pile of rares, go to channelfireball.com/buylist and you can see how much you can get for them. And if you want, you can even trade them in for store credit. Well, they'll give you a big bonus as well. So again, channelfireball.com/buylist. We'll see you next time.